Hi, John.
Hi.
Tom Roddy, The Times. You were talking earlier about penalties in 2018, and I think, if memory serves me right, you were going to be next after Eric Dier in the Colombia game. Yeah, and it just made me wonder whether, like this year round, whether the order of penalty takers is already sort of planned at all, or how that is, or how it's planned.
Yeah, no, not yet. We spoke about order or placements, what people prefer, and I think that comes down to when the team's selected, and obviously we're in that period of a tournament now where it's knockout, so we're probably going to enter one of those penalty shootouts, and hopefully not, but you know, it's part of the game, so we have to be prepared for it. And today we've done practicing on penalties. The lads who didn't complete a full session yesterday did them today. So, you know, we're trying to keep it a routine thing and keep it in the back of our minds that, it's fluent within our training sessions, that we keep up to speed and know what we're doing. And then obviously it's down to the manager to choose. And as you said, yeah, I was next after Eric. We'll see this time.
Hi, John. It's Matt Lowe at The Telegraph. We seem to tie ourselves in knots about Harry Kane every tournament. We get into sort of pointless debates about if he has scored, if he hasn't scored, does he need a rest, does he not need a rest. At your club, you play with someone that everyone's got very excited about, Erling Haaland, and we sometimes, I think, get more excited about sort of foreign players than our own players. Mm-hmm. Having played with both of them, and I know they're different, can be different types of striker, is Harry every bit as good as Erling Haaland, do you think?
Definitely. It's difficult to obviously say Erling, so new to our league, and Harry's been playing it all his life pretty much. But yeah, players that like those two that you mentioned, their quality always shines through within circumstances like you've just said. Maybe does he need a rest, or we never think like that, but I know from what you've just said that gets spoke about. So I think players that usually are scoring, like Harry, and wants to score. I think you've seen also his assist the other day was incredible. But those sort of players are a massive team player as well. You know, the things that don't get spoke about, the positioning, the headers from corners that us as defenders appreciate massively, and what he brings to the team as a leader and as a person, as a presence, can outweigh sometimes what happens or the outcome of things. So, you know, they're both incredible players and incredible within their own rights as well. So, Harry's been always been incredible for me, incredible to play with, and I'm sure he'll get on the score sheet soon.
Hi, John. It's Jacob Steinberg from The Guardian. There's a perception or a narrative that if England lose this game, it could be Gareth Southgate's last game as England manager. If you think of the journey that he's taken you on in the last 4 or 5 years, and you know the relaxed environment that you were talking about before, which I'm sure he's had a big part in creating, would you hope that that's not the case, that whatever happens in the next couple of days or weeks, whatever happens, that he stays on beyond the World Cup?
Yeah, I don't want to think about that, to be honest. it's a difficult one to answer, but the outcome of this game, in my point of view, I hope is positive, and whatever has been put in place continues and continues to grow as well. As a England squad or England FA, the players, the environment, the culture that we've, and as you said, as Gareth has implemented, along with his staff and everything that comes with that, is now a benchmark that we've set for ourselves as a team or players, new players that are coming in. And yeah, I don't ever want to think about someone leaving or that's their time up. I think what we've done as a nation and Gareth's done for us as a team and as a squad and has been incredible, and these things hopefully can keep continue.
Hi, John. Nizar Kinsella here, Evening Standard. I just wanted to ask about sort of your relationship with your own game. Like, you know, you're a Yorkshireman, you seem quite relaxed, but, you know, you play for one of the best clubs in the world and you want to win the World Cup. So do you kind of want to push yourself to become maybe the best centre-back in the world, or do you have those kind of ambitions to be seen that way as, like, you know, one of the best, always be in the conversations as, yeah, John Stones is one of the best centre-backs in the world?
Oof. I think your football's got to do the talking for that. I think, you know, I try and give everything, and I try and do my best with every game, keep a clean sheet, improve as a player, as a person. You know, I'd love to be regarded as one of the best in the world. I think every player would. But, yeah, I think that comes with performances and being recognised for me is comes below winning. I think, you know, all I want to do is win. I've been lucky enough to win 11 titles at City and enjoyed every bit of it, but that's year on year, it's just got stronger, that feeling to win more. And I think you know, I just want to be a good team player. You know, you can't win everything by yourself. I want to be the a good defensive unit, a good defender, keeping clean sheets, playing good football, setting attacks up from the back and whatever that comes with. And I think, you know, kind of answer your question is, yeah, that'd come or does come when with performances and backing that up season upon season.
Okay, three to finish. That'd be Charlie, Andy, then Sammy.
John, Charlie White from The Sun. You mentioned how it's a great motivation not to fall into the category of underachieving. Have the players spoken much about that, about how, you know, moving on and not falling into the trap of maybe thinking things are a bit easy? Because you've obviously seen, I know you said you didn't want to mention Belgium or Germany, but we've seen with England, haven't we, over previous tournaments a few years back, that the potential wasn't really fulfilled, was it?
Yeah. No, we definitely can't hide away from that in our past anyway. Yeah, no, we spoke briefly in our meeting this morning as a team and not letting any standards drop, whether it might be putting your kit the right way. for the kit men, which you know, whether that might be putting our socks the right way for the kit men. We get on each other for things like that because we've created those standards that those little things matter and the little things keep you on the right path. So, yeah, we spoke about what's happened and what the you know, big nations that have gone out, and that we definitely can't make that... that can't be ourselves, sorry. And that goes with all the little things that we've been doing and all the good traits that we've got as a team and as players. We can't let those slip or slide and to make sure that we remain focused and focused on the job in hand. Thanks.
Hi, John. Andy Dunn from the Daily Mirror. Just 4 years ago, you were part of the team and the defence that played against Croatia in that semi-final and let that one goal lead slip. You were right in the thick of that. How long did it take you to get over that? And is that a motivation at this World Cup for you personally, considering also that maybe a year later, Nations League, you didn't have the happiest time then, you had to spell out the team after that. Is that a big motivation for you, what happened 4 years ago, to you personally and to the team at that World Cup?
Yeah, 100%. I think because coming so close twice now, especially the last tournament, yeah, and you never want to go through that feeling again. And it's probably more than likely that I will through my career. So I can't get my head around that, but I always want to better whatever I've done from previous times. And obviously getting fourth at a World Cup was incredible from where we came from. And I think since 2018, we've built so much that we need to better that and some more as well. It's always difficult when I look back on tournaments or difficult times when you've come away and viewed it as a success in some aspects, because I think it was definitely from 2018 a success in the terms of uniting the nation and everyone loving English football again. But then you look at it and realise that we were so close and wanted to do more, and I think that's kind of somewhere that I don't want to be again. I mentioned previously the things that I've been lucky enough to win, and you know, this is something that everyone dreams of as a kid or as a fan that wants their team to win, and we've got to better what we did last time. I think that's the long and short of it.
Final question.
John, Sammy Mockbrot at Daily Mail. Can I just take you back to your answer about the team meeting this morning and the standards that you guys are setting?
Mm-hmm.
Sort of apart from putting your socks on the right way, like you say, you set such high standards here. Can I just get a bit more insight into what you spoke about and what you mean about not letting those standards slip?
Yeah, I think I really think it's the small things for your teammates. You know, not being late to meetings, as I mentioned, kit. All those. If you start getting sloppy with the little things, the bigger things start to get sloppy very easy. So I think it was just a quiet reminder from everyone that we need to, you know, remain and keep our standards and be conscious of those as well, because we're here together, we're here, and we respect each other, and we are all fighting for the same thing. So any 1%, 2% things that we can do to get better, obviously those are small things, but they matter to us, and then that takes and transfers onto the training pitch where we've been sloppy off it, we might be sloppy on it. You know, we've got to train well, we've got to fight for each other, we've got to do the small details well. And as I mentioned about us already doing penalties, again, they're the little 1-2% that we can improve on as players, and that we're consciously thinking about, you know, leading into matches. For when we get there, that we know we've ticked every box. It's a hard one to describe to you, that. I think it's... When you're inside it, you know the standards, and you know what's expected of you. So it's about being together and picking someone up when they've done maybe let something slide a bit, or not realise they've let something slide, and having that unity. To answer your question, I hope I've done it all right.
No. And was that led by? Presumably, that meeting was led by Harry Kane and the senior players.
Yeah, the manager, Harry. Yeah, a few of the boys spoke up. Yeah.
Thanks, everyone. We'll end it there. Appreciate your time.
Cheers, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.